Hey everyone, I hope you're doing well. Welcome to another Fatherhood vlog, and I like to call this Life as an HSP Father, because I'm pretty much a self-identified, highly sensitive person, and I'll touch on that a little bit for those of you that may be new to that term. But it pretty much describes, you know, who I am, and I think it plays a huge role. And of course, because it's not only is what I am, but as far as how I am as a father. So I'm gonna talk about, for those of you who are new to this series, it's been a while since I've done a video on this. I've only done like four or five of them total, I think, ever since ever since like 2011 or 2012, actually, I think. And this is just a chance for me to kind of share the things that I've learned, my own experiences, my faults, you know, the trials and tribulations of being a father. You know, I'm not perfect. I'm human, just like everyone else. Even though a lot of us YouTubers just portray this perfect little image here that you see, you don't really get to see a lot of our personal lives. You know, it's a way for me to kind of, you know, talk about what I learned. You know, I'm a huge believer in knowledge sharing. You know, I think knowledge, you know, should be free and all that. And, you know, we can learn a lot from each other. And especially for those out there who are expecting parents, who I know there's a lot of younger viewers out there, and I don't mean to say that like, you know, I'm some old, well, I am an old, old head, but I don't mean to come across condescending. I just know that there's a lot of teens and such, young adults, young men out there that watch, and so, you know, hopefully some of this, you know, might be of use to someone. And if not, maybe hopefully something you can fall asleep to. I have with me a Moleskine journal, which I've written some notes down just like, you know, 10 minutes before this video, which is normally how I operate. Yeah, so I'm gonna refer to some of the notes in here. But before we get to all that, as the title suggests, this is also a beer review. I also have a portable legume satchel. Some people call it a portable legume satchel. I call it a peanut sack. Wink, wink. I have this out of your gourd pumpkin porter. My wife bought this, like, I think back in September, and I've been holding off just till around this time. So we are gonna take a look at this first, do a little modest beer review, and see what I think about it. I actually want to do a Oktoberfest type, or that, and a little bit of a seasonal video where I review like four or five, you know, taste four or five different brews. But I don't want to open up four or five and then not have any bottle savers. I wanted to get those, you know, they make these little things that you put on top wine bottles and beer bottles to save the beverage, you know, to keep it to keep to act as a lid. But I don't have any of those, and I wanted to get those, but I don't know where to get them. Anyway, but before we get all that, you know, we gotta limber up and do our exercises. You know, it's really important that you get your exercises every day. And even if you just think about exercising, you can burn some calories doing that. I think about exercising a lot, actually. So that's pretty much how I keep a healthy lifestyle. I think about exercising, then I know I burn a few calories doing that, and next thing I know, hey, I'm doing all right, you know. But, anyway, so you can follow along if you want. We're going to do 10 of these, 10 reps. If you want, you can raise your up, you know, arms, follow along with the bottle cap opener if you like. Or you can just watch it, follow with your eyes. You'll burn calories that way too. All right, here we go. You ready? So I'm going to go. 1, 2. So let's take a look at this Redhook out of your Gourd pumpkin porter seasonal series. Did I say Redhook? I have Batman on the brain. Redhook. And hopefully you can see that. You should be able to see that. Established 1981, Seattle. Bottled on July 3rd of this year, 2014. And let's see, what does it say? No description. Pumpkin porter. I have no idea what this gets. Redhook Brewery out of Woodinville, Washington. Portsmouth, New Hampshire. Portland, Oregon. Let me see if I can pull this up real quick on the interwebs. Out of your Gourd Beer Advocate. Let's see what Beer Advocate gives it. Overall rating of 79%. So that's pretty good. So I guess that's like 4 stars, I think. Out of 300 and some ratings, 64 reviews, average is 3.45, so 3.5 stars. So I'm expecting a little above than average. I'm not gonna, you know, a lot of people give it 3.5 and above. So we'll see. I'm expecting some pumpkin aroma, some pumpkin flavor. We'll see. So let's get this open. And as I always say, drink responsibly. Don't drink and drive, of course. I don't mean to sound like that guy, but I did have a viewer say that. They've been taking some of my advice or listening to some of my advice in regards to knowing your limits. You know, one thing they don't teach, at least I was never taught, is how to handle alcohol. I mean, because let's face it, a lot of folks are going to drink alcohol at some point in their lives, and all we're usually taught is don't drink. And that doesn't doesn't, that's not really helpful. You need to have a like, you know, allow somehow in a controlled environment, young adults who are either of age to drink or close to it, to taste alcohol and to understand how to handle it. Because once you get the effects of the alcohol and you start to become inebriated or buzz, whatever you want to call it, you know, that's pretty much where you should stop. And you definitely don't want to overdo it. But anyway. So here's just some bottle cap tapping sounds. I know a lot of folks enjoy those sounds. I actually did a whole hour's worth of this. Well, it's 20 minutes looped for an hour. I have an hour's worth of beer suds sounds, a separate hour's worth of bottle cap tapping, and then both of them combined into one video. So if you enjoy these particular sounds, you can check those out. It's 1 hour of binaural beer suds and then 1 hour of binaural bottle cap tapping, I think is how it is. And there's no speaking in either one of those, so. It's been a while since I've had a beer. I think it's been about 2 weeks. I would like to do these beer reviews at least once a week, but honestly, I don't drink beer that often because drinking at home, it usually knocks me out. One beer and I'm half asleep. You know, when you have company or you're out, it's different. You know, you're kind of awake and you're going, but when you just sit at home and you drink, it's, you know, night time. All right, so here we go. Give us a nice pour here. Get my face out of the glass. Hopefully you can hear those suds. Decent head. Not too much lacing, and the head kind of dissipates fairly quickly. I don't know the mechanics of how the head, what retains, what keeps head retention. But that dissipated pretty quickly. I can smell the porter as far as the malt is concerned. Pumpkin. Now, my allergies have been bothering me a lot lately, but I'm not really smelling pumpkin too much. It's smells like a typical porter, so we'll do a little cheers here for all the fathers out there, or even the expecting fathers, or even if you know, for your father, if you're not a father but have a father, for your father. Have I said father? Not if you want to count how many times I said father, including the time I just said now. I think it's like 7. Anyway, cheers. Cling. Not much of a pumpkin taste, but I am getting, I don't know if I want to say a floral or fruity type of flavor there. It's smooth, it's creamy. There's something definitely sitting high on my palate that's giving it almost a sweet kind of taste, and it could be the pumpkin, but I'm not like smelling or tasting pumpkin like pumpkin pie at all. Nice and malty, no bitters, hardly at all anything bitter, unless I've just become completely numb to anything that's bitter, but it's delicious. Not bitter at all, but nothing too exceptional about this, unfortunately. I mean, no offense to the company at all, but I'm not really getting, I mean, slight pumpkin, but I can definitely, there's definitely like a floral type aroma. You know, this is, I gotta give this 3. I'm not really, really impressed. And don't get me wrong, I'm not a beer connoisseur at all. I'm not an expert. You know, I just like to try different types of beer, and I usually rate, my ratings are usually just based on, you know, what it's trying to be, and how I like it compared to all the various beers that I've had, if I would drink it again, like that. So, you know, I'm not here to really promote companies as much as I am, just to say, you know, whether I like it or not. That's all. It's, you know. Three stars, that's... It feels like it's falling flat. After I drink and swallow the beer, it's almost like it is just, it's kind of flat. I mean, as far as the mouthfeel, it feels kind of weak. Or maybe I'm just having an off night, but it's not bad. I wouldn't go out of my way to buy it again, because it's not like anything exceptional. So I don't want to keep saying talk down, because in case there's any fans out there or anyone that really enjoys it, you know, again, this is just my take on the taste of it. So yeah, you know, Redhook, not bad. You know, check it out. See for yourself. Don't just take my word on it. I'm going to have some peanuts here. Some viewers out there who are fathers, parents, mothers, definitely want to say my heart and my sympathies out there for those of you that may have had a father and lost them, or any kind of parent, mother, or if you've lost a loved one in that aspect. So. So, fatherhood, it's been 7 years now, being a father, which I never expected, 20s, you know, kind of thought about what it'd be like to be a father, but it wasn't a goal. And it wasn't until I met my wife that everything just fell into place and was a father as of 2007. So 4 years before I started on YouTube. I started my YouTube channel in 2011. Actually, September 14th, 2011. Almost on September 11th. I was a father 4 years before I got on YouTube. YouTube wasn't even on my mind as far as making ASMR videos wasn't on my mind. I mean, you know, I never thought I would be making videos. I never thought I would be doing this. Reaching the folks that I do, it's still surreal, and I don't let any of it get to my head. I still make the same types of videos I do today as I did day one when I had 5 subscribers. You know, I don't just keep doing the, you know. I still have that same kind of mentality. I don't let anything get to my head. But anyway, so life as an HSP father or a parent. HSP, highly sensitive person. All it is a label that was given by psychologist Dr. Elaine Aaron, and it describes a trait that about a quarter of the population, of the world population, about one out of every four, about 20%, 25%. So one out of every five people that you see and come across is a highly sensitive person. Excuse me. And what that means is that some of us have a nervous system that is highly sensitive. That means we process things much more deeply and stronger. I was going to say strongly. Than other folks that are not HSPs. So, and that just means stimuli. And it also affects emotions. So, vision, hearing, sight, smell, they're more acute. And it's not like a superpower. That's just who we are. And the psychologist, and it's been observed in other higher species, animals. Highly sensitive people are like the meerkats of the world. We are like... Dr. Aaron says we are like the priestly advisors, so to speak. Meaning, you have the warrior kings you have the people who are not HSP. They are very gung-ho sometimes, usually for the most part. Very outgoing. Although you can have highly sensitive people who are extroverts and things like that, but the highly sensitive person, a great way to describe it is, will walk into a room at a party, and instead of just going right up to the, you know, instead of socializing and just going right and starting getting to the party, they'll notice what's the mood of the other people, what are they observing. They'll observe, and they'll hear, and they'll take everything in, and being a highly sensitive person makes you prone to being more cautious, extremely cautious. I don't want to say paranoid. There's another word I want to use, but it's been slipping my mind. But anyway, we're just constantly a very highly sensitive system. And it doesn't mean weak. There's a stigma, you know, about... if you're sensitive, you're weak, you're shy, and And that's just, I don't want to say a stereotype. I mean, it's kind of like a stereotype, but I don't want to dwell too much on the HSP thing. But basically, you know, like I said, it's some of us are just so prone. Well, you know, we have these sensitive systems, highly sensitive systems, that we're more prone, you know, to just being withdrawn and appearing shy, because, you know, it's, I'll explain. You know, I take my son out in the summer at a local park to shoot some hoops, play some basketball, or just throwing the frisbee around. And he's very fearful of the basketball coming down, no matter how much that he's done it, and how much he knows that's not going to hurt him. And I throw the frisbee at him, and he doesn't want to catch it. He's still, this was around when he was 6 and turning 7, or, you know, just turned 7 or so. And that's because his body, he knows that's not going to hurt him. But his system is so sensitive to what's going to happen, that fear, that it just takes, it overrides what he knows about it. He knows the basketball is not going to hurt him, but he can't help but to do this and to kind of, you know, back away from the basketball as it comes back down after he shoots it. And that's just how we are. We're not really afraid or weak. We're just like, it's like being a spider on a web. You know, a fly lands on a spider web and it's triggered. Spider, boom, goes and right to the fly. And that's like what it is to be like a high sensitive person. Sight, sound, senses, sense of smell, everything is just triggering and coming in and causing us to react and things like that. So I don't wanna, there's a lot more to it than that, but because I'm an HSP, I mean, it kind of makes sense for me to kind of change the focus of these vlogs instead of just saying I'm a father, kind of, you know, talking about it as a highly sensitive person. So, what do I want to talk about? Well, one of the things I've learned about being a father and being HSP and having anxiety, which pretty much HSP and being an anxious person is almost hand in hand. When our son was born, I was much more anxious, and a lot less calm than I am today. Some of you might be familiar, or some of you might know, when I say, or have experience, when I talk about being somewhat of a control freak. And I wasn't a control freak as far as, you know, tell my wife that she shouldn't wear this because I'm afraid that some guy is going to look at her and she's going to draw attention and I'm an insecure partner, and that happens. You know, a lot of people will be controlling that way because they're afraid that their wife might, or their partner might, find someone else because someone else has found them attractive. But, so, anyway. I wasn't controlling like that. I was more controlling about the things I couldn't control, that are out of my control. You know, I would be at work and, you know, did he eat yet? How's he doing? But just, I was a wreck for the first, you know, good 6 months or so. Or even in daycare. But, you know, even up to that point, you know, I was learning about myself and not worrying about what I can't control. And that's one of the things, whether you're a father or not, mother, parent or not, whoever you are, you can't worry about the things you can't control, especially if you're an empath, which is a trait, or which is largely believed to be a trait. Empathy, which I also believe is kind of linked to being HSP and the link to ASMR. That's a discussion for another day. But being an HSP, I worry a lot. I used to worry a lot. I've tried to learn not to worry as much anymore about almost anything, everything. Nothing worse than obsessing over worrying, or the obsession that is worrying. You know the term worry wart? So that was, you know, something that I learned before I had it, before we had our child, our son. But even after, even today, I don't really care or worry about much. And all I mean by that is, you know, as much as I would like to, I can't save the world. I can't save everyone. And I don't want to get too much, you know, like I said, this is just me rowing my boat down the stream of consciousness. And, you know, taking my boat to the side of the stream and just exploring a little bit these little side topics. But I do care. I care about everyone. I would love to see everyone be able to live a good quality of life. That money, it shouldn't have to, our lives shouldn't have to rely on how much money we have, or our health shouldn't be dependent on how much money we have, our living conditions and all that. I'm not gonna get into all that either, but one of the things about being a father that can make you anxious, can drive you insane, is worrying. Yeah, it's just like when you send your son to daycare, putting him in the hands of strangers. Made me very anxious, worrying, and I just had to learn to trust. I had to learn to trust others, and because I'm a very cynical person, not just because of the shit that I went through as a kid and you know, as a teen, but you know, witnessing a lot of the deplorable actions other members of our species have committed really makes you quite a cynical person, or me, which leads to not trusting people and all that. And so I had to learn not to care and worry so much to a degree, you know? Because I can't control anything beyond what I'm saying and doing right now. Even with my son sleeping right now, who knows what could happen, you know? God forbid a plane come crashing down into the place. I mean, he goes to school. I can't control any of that. What he does with his life, I can't control any of that. You know, what other people do in the world, whether they're good people or bad people, that's not my responsibility. Ends outside of, you know, as far as, you know, who I can reach and the people that I can, you know, people I can reach and whoever I can try to help. You know, and you know, if that makes sense, you know, yeah, so worry, you know, being a highly sensitive person, worry is almost hand in hand, anxiety. So in 7 years, you know, being a father, I learned a lot. I was also not very social, and again, it's kind of a highly sensitive person thing. You know, I didn't like being having to be in certain environments that I didn't want to be, didn't want to socialize, you know, and I'm still like that to a degree, but I'm much better at playing the role of a parent and going to, you know, social gatherings, taking, you know, our son out to events or going to school events and stuff like that, and playing the part of a you know, a smiling, happy father. Not that I'm not a happy father, but you know grinning, bearing it. You know, going to a social event geared for the kids, like, say, you know, I don't know, a Halloween parade, and you don't really feel like being there at all, you know, for whatever reason that day, but you go because that's what you do. You're the parent to your son, your child, and they want to go, they want to be a part of it, so you suck it up. And that kind of leads me into, you know, I'm not going to get too deep into a lot of these topics because there's a lot of things I kind of want to talk about. But that's one of the things I wanted to discuss, was that I've had to learn was being selfless. Nothing wrong with being selfish, but I think one of the positive traits of being an empath, being a highly sensitive person, is being selfless. Not trying to brag at all. I'm not Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa, she was a saint. I think, wasn't she ordained a saint? I'm not even sure, but that was an amazing human being. And, you know, the people that can actually go to these rundown parts of the world, third world countries, whatever you want to call it, and just spend their lives helping others in need. Those are amazing people, even everyday people that help special needs kids or adults, whether it's their job or whether it's part-time or for whatever reason they do it, they should be heralded more than actors and singers and politicians. But you know, that's selflessness. And being a parent, you need to learn how to be selfless. That means not living vicariously through your child, not turning them into what you wanted to do with your life. If you never got a chance to play the guitar, we don't force your child to learn how to play. If you like sports, you don't force your child to like sports. They are their own person. They deserve respect. From the moment they are born throughout the rest of their life, they are their own person. They are not a toy. They are not your source of pleasure, of happiness. I mean, and they can be, but they're not here to make you happy. You know, if you're having a child to be a, and I'm not directing this to any of you, but we know that there's some pretty sad examples of parents out there. You know, you don't bring a child in your life. You don't have a child to make you feel good about yourself. For all these, reasons. You're bringing in a human being. You're bringing in another mouth to feed. You're bringing in a person that has feelings. That's going to have their own, that's going to be a mix of you and your wife or your partner, or if you're adopting, they're a mix of whoever brought them into the world. And they are going to be their own, have their own experiences, have their, own view and all this, and their own likes and their own interests. And, and that's something that I've learned to remember and to keep in mind is that I like video games, but I know they're a drug. I know they're addictive, and I can tell you for a fact that they are, because we would have our son would play a video game, and after like 15 minutes, pull him away, and he's crying, he's upset, and he's a completely another person. And because of the video games, they really fuck with your head. And that needs to be moderated. It's definitely an addiction. No doubt in my mind. If it's not moderated properly, because it basically, it pleases your senses, and without you having to do anything, it's really like a drug. But I like video games, and I tried actually to avoid him. I'd said forever, he's not gonna play video games. We'll never have a video game system. I won't introduce video games until he's like 12 years old. Well, that didn't last long. He was introducing the video games when he was probably 5. We held off as long as we could. But we moderate. He can play. He does good in school. He doesn't play video games every night. He doesn't wake up first thing. And even himself, now that he's 7, he sometimes even doesn't go to the video games. Not because we have a rule or anything. We're very liberal. But, you know, he'll just sometimes wake up and he'll go, maybe he'll read some books. Or maybe he'll go play with his Legos. But it's pretty much, you know, we determine when video games can be played. But we're strict about it, but we're kind of lenient. But we moderate it, you know, make sure he's doing other things as well. So the video game thing, you know, he likes to do the Minecraft on the iPad. We limit it. And some days, you know, we don't really give a fuck. And he can play for an hour or two at night. And then sometimes we'll go for a week and he won't play for 3 or 4 days. So, it's all about moderation. As long as you know overall that he's not constant, that your child is not constantly playing video games every day, every night, and video games. You know, just like when it comes down to food. Anything, everything in moderation. Really. One of the other things I want to talk about. So one of the other things I want to talk about in regards to, you know, not living vicariously through our children, respecting them as their own individuals, respecting what they want, is, and this kind of relates to your own anxiety, your own issues, is not to project your shadow onto your child. And what I mean by that, it's a Carl Jung term. You know, your shadow contains your fears, your insecurities, all, you know, the repressed stuff, the stuff that you haven't really faced yet, that you haven't brought into your conscious world and learn how to adapt it into your daily life, or how to overcome them. So that's one of the things I had to learn as a father, was make sure that whatever my anxieties are, my fears, my insecurities are, that I don't project that onto our son, so that, you know, he already has his own emotional imprint, DNA imprint, you know. There's emotional DNA, there's physiological DNA, and there's also psychological DNA. What I just mean by that is, you know, the same stuff that makes us who we are physically, bones, nervous system, etc., eye color. We have the same kind of makeup and traits as far as our psyche is concerned, you know, the things that we have the collective fears as a species, or as a certain type of person, you know, we might share the same collective trait of being a highly sensitive person, but then we also have our own unique traits that others might share too, but they're more, you know, whatever it might be, fear of heights, for example. But you don't want to, you know, your child is going to have all this, their own makeup, physical and psychological makeup. You don't want to make that worse by projecting your fears onto them. What I mean by that is, if you don't like going outside and being social, and you don't like being social a lot, you have to overcome that, because your child might want to be social. And also, if you like to be social, it goes the opposite way too. If you like to be social and outgoing, well, maybe you have a highly sensitive child that you think is shy or weak. That's not the case. They are just, our nervous systems just take in so much, it makes us prone to be more cautious in almost everything we do. So, you know, don't project yourself. Don't turn your child into who you are. It's hard, because we are what we are, day in and day out. You know, you can't just flip a switch and be someone you're not. But you have to learn how to control, you know, your insecurities, your fears, and things like that. And you want to learn and understand about your child, you know, what their strengths are, what their weaknesses are, you know, what are the things that they're afraid of, so that you know what environments work for them. You know, pay attention, you know, to the signs. We're not going to force our son into sports. You know, parents these days, it's just like sports. Sportsing. Get the points. That's all everybody seems to be concerned about, you know. Our son, he's not much of a sport. He's more of a, you know, he's a highly sensitive person, so he's prone to being more of an analytical tinkerer, builder, creative type. He's already trying to create his own card game. So I'm not going to force him to join the baseball team just because he should be in sports, you know, or because I love baseball and I think he should be in sports. You know, try to introduce him to it. See if he's interested in it. But learn, understand, they're their own person. You know? I think a lot of parents just don't get that. And one of the other things is, you understand what your child likes and try to nurture what they're good at. Do they like to draw? Encourage them to draw. Nurture that, because, you know, we live in this economic world where you have to do something to earn money just so we can eat, even though food at one time was abundant on the planet and freely available for anyone to acquire. But now it's, I'm getting off on a tangent. So we need money to eat, to live. And, you know, no one grows up wanting to work at a desk 8 hours a day under artificial life and live a sedimentary lifestyle 8 hours a day without getting much exercise. I think everybody wants to grow up to be an astronaut, a musician, whatever. Encourage your child, nurture them, nurture their strengths from an early age, you know, and get that going. And Don't ever stop. Don't let them just play video games. Don't just say. And I'll be honest, there are days I don't really give a fuck. I'm just like, go play. I'm just tired. I've had a bad day at work or whatever it is. And, you know, go play video games. But that's not every day. You know, I come home from work. We spend time as a family. And then, you know, he goes to bed. And then whatever after that. You know, but we try, you know, he is in, he's got a little, he's in second grade, and he's got a little aftercare class where he's doing art. He's got another aftercare class where he does some science. And then we just signed him up for Taekwondo to try to get him involved in something more, like something fitness related or exercise related, since he's not a sports person. So why not Taekwondo? You know, something that's going to challenge him physically, and he likes, you know, he's like me, he likes to be challenged. I mean, he doesn't know that he likes to be challenged, but his body wants to be challenged, if you know what I mean. You know, and spend time doing, going back to being selfless. You know, you gotta sometimes spend time doing what you don't like to do because that's what they like to do. Getting towards the end here, and I wanted to hit on some more things. If you don't like to draw, but they like to draw, and just because you're not into whatever they like, well, you're gonna have to suck it up and get into it, because that's their own person, that's what they want. And just try to put yourself in their shoes, in other person's shoes. Some people don't have empathy, they don't have that trait, they don't know what it's like. They can't put themselves into someone else's shoes. They do. That's why the world is like it is, because you have some people who have empathy, you have some people who don't. It's just the nature of the beast. But yeah, you know, that's something that I try to improve on, and then I've done that I've done for a long time, pretty much, is whatever interests him is important, and that I should respect that and make it, and do what I can to, even as sometimes as tired as I may be, you know, just before I made this video tonight, you know, we got up at 6 o'clock in the morning because he had to get some minor surgery, and he had ear tubes, and one of his eardrum didn't heal, so they had to plug it. In layman's terms, and I went to bed early last night too, but it didn't matter. So I was 7:30 rolled around tonight, before I made this video, and I was tired, and he wanted to play Legos, so I played Legos with him a little bit, and after 15 minutes, I was like, hey, bud, you know, kind of tired, you know, I'll just kind of move the guy around, but I really wasn't into it, even though he still was, you know, and then I just kind of was like, all right, but I gotta take a break, I'm a little tired, you know, daddy's a little tired, but, you know, I sucked it up as much as I could. But any other time he wants to play, you know, can we do this, do this, you know, that's the priority in life, that little human being, so, last thing is two things. Three things. Try to expose them to as many things as you can in life. Culture them. You know, whatever that might be. Just keep exposing to new things. You know, there's just so much in this life. So many wonderful things. Whether, you know, and whether it's, you know, books, going on a hike, you know, who knows? You know, don't let their life become stagnant. Number two, try to maintain the innocence in the world for them. You may be cynical and hate everybody and hate the world, because believe me, I've been there and I'm still there sometimes. But to them, you know, remember what it was like when you were a kid and the world was just awesome. It was great. It was happy. It was sunshine and, you know, it was innocent. And then you gotta maintain that. You know, you don't want, you know, you just need to maintain that, the innocence of the world, the child's eyes. And think, read to your child every night. I don't mean to brag, but we've been reading to our son 2 or 3 books every night since he was born. Even before he was born, I was reading to him outside the womb. So you can do the math, 2 books minimum a night, 350, you know, 360 days a year times 7 years. That's how many stories we've read to our son. You know, some nights we haven't, but almost every night, 2 books at bedtime. You know, read. Very important. Make sure you read to them. Make sure they can, you know, they're reading. You know, that's why it's important to moderate the video games. But yeah. Reading is so important. So, I hope I, and like I said, that, you know, life as an HSP father, it's learning a lot about yourself. Life is always learning about yourself and, you know, improving from your mistakes, learning from your mistakes and improving, trying not to repeat the same mistakes, learning about yourself, you know. What are your weak? What are your insecurities? What makes you anxious? Learning how to manage, self-manage, learning how to overcome all that. Because you need to get that shit in control when you become a father, because you don't want to make your child a nervous wreck, because you're a nervous wreck, you know. You want your child to have a nice, peaceful, innocent life for as long as possible, until they become cynical of the world on their own without you having to influence them. You know, and I'll tell you, we're getting here at the very end, you know, he's tested my patience. I'll tell you, I raised my voice, but I never raised my hand to him. I have, you know, gripped him firmly, but that's the extent of it. And, you know, I'm not really a believer in physical enforcement, or whatever you want to call it. I don't know what the correct term is. I think there's other ways, you know, to handle situations. You talk, you know, and we've been treating our son like his own person, like an adult, insofar as him understanding why we're upset, things he's doing. You know, we never treat him like a child. We never act like he doesn't know anything and all this, or he's stupid, or any of that. You know, So, but at the same time, you don't want to treat them like an adult, because that can be, it's not really a form of abuse, but it takes them out of that being a child. You know, you don't want to make them feel guilty. You don't want to, it's hard to explain what I'm trying to say with that. You want to have that talk with them, the openness with them, and that respect, and you're a parent, but you're not above them. You're not better than them. You know, it's respect, I guess. It's hard to say what I'm trying to say. But, all right, I hope I kind of explained some things that I wanted to, you know, these are really rambly type. You know, I'm not trying to come across like I have all the answers in the world, or I'm a perfect father. You know, I may have repeated myself from previous videos, but I've been wanting to do one like these for a while. So, I hope there's something that somebody can glean from this. But, yeah, so. Thanks for watching. Appreciate the support, and for all the fathers out there, even the mothers, parents, guardians, grandparents, expecting parents, or even any of you who are teens, you know, children are, you know, important, and they're going to grow up, and they're going to either become positive people, productive people in this world, or they're going to turn into, you know, whatever. So, yeah. All right. Thanks for watching, and until next time, take care of yourself. Stay well, be kind to one another. Peace.